Welcome. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus, and welcome to this time of worship of the United Methodist Church of Westport and Weston. I am Reverend Heather Sinclair, and it is a blessing for us to be gathered together through the miracle of technology to worship together from near and far. I hope that you are following us on our website or on the email list. If you want to be connected to the church, that is the best way to find out what is going on. And of course, you may reach out and contact me if you have any questions about our online worship or the ways that we are continuing to be the church in these days. Zoom fellowship will follow worship this morning about 10 minutes after the end of the service. If you need the link to join us, please text me or send an email. It's a fun time for us to connect and see each other's faces as we begin a new week. Now let us prepare our hearts for worship as we listen to the prelude.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my
Let us join our hearts in prayer. Life-giving God, we gather in your presence to offer you thanksgiving and praise for all that you have done. Through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have been set free. Free from the power of sin that leads to death, free to follow the leading of your Holy Spirit, free to love you with all our heart and soul and strength, free to worship. Forgive us for the times when we have put aside the life-giving freedom that comes from you and embraced a self-centered freedom that weighs us down, impedes our faithful decision-making, and denies other children of God your freedom and justice. Free us for joyful obedience to you. In the light of your mercy, may your Holy Spirit inspire our praise and our prayers. Open our hearts and minds to your presence among us and within us, and to the word of grace you have for us today. To you alone, life-giving God, belongs all honor and praise and glory and blessing, now and to the end of time. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Amen. Peace be with you. Share the peace of Christ. Hi, good morning. I am actually filming this on Friday when there is a storm going on outside. It's been raining pretty heavy and some wind. I haven't heard any thunder yet, but that might be coming as well. So we started collecting lamps and candles and flashlights and even a headlamp just in case we lose power and need something to light our way tonight. Which reminded me of the scripture that is on your coloring page for today. Grace and Sophia got a start on theirs, and it says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." The word of God is what we call scripture, the Bible. The word of God includes stories and poems and rules that God has created for us to live in this world. And so they are a light, something that guides us and leads us on the path of our life. When we're afraid, when we're in a time of darkness and we're not sure where to go, we can turn to the Bible. We can turn to the passages that remind us that God loves us. We can turn to the places where God helps remind us what it is we need to do to care for our neighbors. We can turn to the places where God's people have been through tough times before and have made it through with God as their light. And so the Word of God becomes for us like a lamp. It lights our path. It helps us to not trip and fall in the dark, and it reminds us that God is with us always. So I hope that you have not lost power this weekend in the middle of the storm. If you have, that you have had a light. And I hope that you might open your Bible and read it. Find a place where God is giving you light and direction and a way to go. And remember that God is with you always. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your light, for your word that is like a lamp to our feet that guides our path and is with us even in the darkest times. Be with us always, God, and light our path. In Jesus' name, amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from the New Testament, the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. By the time Paul gets to chapter 8 of Romans, he has described in graphic and dramatic detail the shadowlands of the gospel, the darkness into which the light of the gospel has shone, and the challenge that that light has to stay bright. At the beginning of chapter 8, Paul focuses on the gospel apart from the shadowy edges that it must contend with. With a ringing and positive and strong voice, Paul says with conviction as follows. So now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own Son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his Son as a sacrifice for our sins. And he did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us, who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. For the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's law, and it never will. That's why those who are still under the control of their sinful nature can never please God. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to him at all. And Christ lives within you. So even though your body will die because of sin, the Spirit gives you life because you have been made right with God. The Spirit of God raised Jesus from the dead, lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by this same Spirit living within you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Our evolving worship format allows us now to share and connect in new and different ways. Preachers can now pulpit swap without actually swapping pulpits. This morning, it is a blessing to welcome the members of Stratford UMC who are hearing this sermon as part of their online worship. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, for you are our strength and our salvation. Amen. Romans 8 is the crowning chapter in the Apostle Paul's letter to the fledgling Christian community in Rome. As Ralph said in his scripture introduction, with the beginning of this chapter, we come out of the shadows and into the glorious light of the declaration, there is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. From here, Paul will wrestle with the groaning and suffering of the world, the unseen hope with which we wait for glory, and the powerful love of God through Jesus Christ, from which nothing can separate us. So let's review for a moment where we've been on this journey in ancient Rome. We've arrived at this pinnacle from the depths of the sinful nature that Paul asserts dwells in each of us. Sin is that which breaks down our relationship with God and one another, convincing us that we do not do what we want to do. Thanks be to God, grace through Christ can rescue us. The freedom which we have in Christ comes from our baptism, in which we die to sin and rise again to new life in Christ, just as Christ was raised in resurrection from the dead. Our freedom in Christ does not permit us to do whatever we wish, but rather brings us obediently in line with the will of God. Freedom in Christ opens our eyes and our hearts to the sin inside us, but also the sinful systems that pervade our culture and the world. As God's beloved children, we are called to strive against the sins of racism, classism, sexism, and more. Those sins that restrict the freedom of all of God's children. To live in the freedom in Christ is to walk in newness of life, to be guided by faith and the covenant made by and for us at our baptism. That new life will carry us through times of suffering, producing endurance, patience, and hope that comes from trusting that God walks with us. For Paul's message to the Romans, this entire journey of faith in Christ goes back to his opening proclamation in chapter 1, verses 16 to 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed through faith. As it is written, the one who is righteous will live by faith. Those who live by faith in Christ are those who now find no condemnation in Christ. For the law of the Spirit of life in Jesus Christ has set you free. Again and again, Paul uses this key phrase, in Christ. I paused and noted that I had written it at least 10 times in that first part of the sermon. Nowhere does Paul name the people of the Roman community or any community that he is shepherding Christians. Rather, they are in Christ. We cannot be merely labeled as followers of Christ. We must live as followers of Christ. The crucial question is, how can we be in Christ in today's world? Pastor Karen Keokian explains it this way. Imagine you wish to paint, not in a beginner's sort of way, but beautifully, like Michelangelo. No matter how many lessons you take, how much you practice, how hard you try, you simply cannot do it. Even if you are very gifted, you will only create a facsimile of his masterful art. The only way to paint like Michelangelo is to be Michelangelo. And of course, you cannot do that either. Unless the spirit of Michelangelo is to live within you. Then and only then could you create such beauty. So it is with Christ's spirit dwelling in us. We are, thanks be to God, able to live life in the Spirit of God. It is not our own accomplishment, but Christ's Spirit dwelling in us, empowering us to live in God's righteousness. This is the, quote, impossible impossibility of which the theologian Karl Barth writes in his commentary Epistle to the Romans. By our own power and volition, it is impossible. The history of humanity and of God's people is all the proof one needs. By the power of God, through our minds, can be set free on what the Spirit desires. To be in Christ means we must live not only striving to do what Jesus would do, but believing that the Spirit of Christ lives and moves within us. Now, I find that the Holy Spirit is the most challenging person of the Trinity to grasp because of its intangible and invisible nature. In our faithful imaginations, our Creator God, he or she or beyond any gender, creates the world, speaks through everyday people and mighty prophets, appears in clouds and burning bushes, sits in the heavens or at the farthest edges of the sea. And the gospel accounts of Jesus present us with a person, fully human and fully divine, one who walked and talked and touched and ate and dined and died in a particular time and place in history. In our mind's eye, we see God and Jesus, the first two persons of the Trinity. In contrast, the Holy Spirit rushes in like wind, like a dove, like flames, offering peace and inspiration, opening eyes and hearts and lifting a multitude of voices, but never seen or touched or heard. When Jesus promises the coming of the Holy Spirit to his disciples, he says, "The advocate, the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you." To be in Christ is to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and allow that Spirit to help, to teach, to remind, and inspire us in the ways of Christ. It is the Holy Spirit that guides us and navigates the challenges of life and faith in this world. Living life according to the Spirit is not automatic or easy. Paul describes a constant tension between the flesh and the spirit. Now, to be clear, the word flesh here is not the same as body. These passages have been interpreted in ways that create a harmful duality between body and spirit. All bodies and spirits are beautifully and wonderfully made by God. Our bodies and our spirits are intricately connected. We know, we have witnessed, and we have felt in ourselves that broken hearts and spirits can lead to broken bodies. Stress and sleeplessness, ulcers and high blood pressure, the list could go on. In this time of viral pandemic, there are millions of bodies sick and tens and thousands dying, struggling to breathe. There are countless more bodies and spirits that are broken by grief and isolation and fear. We can test for a virus and track its system, its symptoms and antibodies, but the very real emotional and spiritual pain may lie deeper and even more complicated to heal. So we need to prayerfully and lovingly care for ourselves and each other to mend those wounds. We need to rest, to connect, to listen, to remind ourselves and others that we are enough in the eyes of God and that we are loved unconditionally. The things of the flesh, the sinful nature, turn us away from God's will and block the lively movement of the Holy Spirit within us. Setting the mind on the flesh means living according to the broken ways of the world. Greed, anger, resentment, violence, pride, fear due to indifference, lack of respect for our neighbors. These things of the flesh tear at the healthy bodies of our society, our church, our relationships, our own hearts and souls. To be in Christ in the world means to be attentive to those fleshy ways that rise up in us. We need to do the hard work of examining our own ways and allowing the Spirit to transform our hearts and minds. To be in Christ in this world means to work to repair and restore the damage that has been done to our neighbors and commit to acts of justice, compassion, and mercy. To live in Christ is to allow the Spirit of Christ into your spirit so that you may follow the example of the life of Christ. So many stories of Jesus come to mind as I consider how we are guided to live our lives as Christ lived. One of my favorite stories is Jesus' encounter with a Samaritan woman at the well. as told in the fourth chapter of the Gospel of John. I hope that you might open your Bibles and read that story for yourselves. Jesus is resting at the well. He's caring for his body and his spirit after a long journey. He sent his disciples into the village to get food to nourish their bodies. He's caring for himself so that he can continue to minister to others. When he encounters a Samaritan woman, one who has been shunned by her community and to whom no good Jew would speak, Jesus engages in conversation. He shows that he is not bound by the preconceived barriers of culture and race and gender. Jesus listens to this woman and acknowledges her pain and difficult circumstances. There is no condemnation from Christ, but there is challenge. Challenge to seek God through worship and belief in eternal life. Through this encounter, the woman is invited to receive living water, more abundant and grace-filled than simply the water of the well. Her heart and her spirit are transformed by Christ, and her life is changed so dramatically that she returns to the community to praise God and to tell the good news. This is life in Christ. To encounter those living with broken spirits, those weighed down by sin, and to invite them to receive the loving and grace-filled Spirit of Christ that has the power to transform and to renew lives. And then, that new life in Christ is inspired by the Spirit to live and serve in Christ so that others' minds and hearts may be free. Brothers and sisters, this is our call, to live in Christ, to receive the Spirit of Christ, and invite others to live in Christ as well. Let us pray. O God, set us free. Set us free from the weights of sin that drag us down. Set us free to see the weight of sin that holds others down. Breathe into us your Holy Spirit, so that we may set our minds and hearts on your grace and power, which inspires the impossible possibility of transformation. As your church, may we be witnesses and an instrument of your peace and justice. May our lives and our gifts be examples of our faith in Christ. Amen. Thank you. Let us, in a moment of silent reflection, lift our prayers, our joys, our concerns, our celebrations, and our struggles, the names of those who we love, those we know, and those we don't know. Let us lift those names and situations to God. God of spirit and truth, we thank you for the gift of new life that you have given us through the waters of our baptism. Help us as your chosen and called and baptized people to die daily to sin and rise to new life with Christ in the power of the Spirit. We pray for all those who are mourning the death of a loved one. Comfort them in the knowledge that Jesus has won a victory over death, so that everyone who dies in Christ may have eternal life. Keep us from fearing death, but at times of doubt, help us to put our faith in Jesus. Strengthen us and those in our community and nation to choose life over death, to choose safety rather than rash freedom, to choose health and wellness over illness, to choose wisdom and sound judgment over desire for personal gain. We pray for hospitals and ICUs and hospices, for doctors and nurses and emergency response teams who are working with the dying, especially in these times of pandemic. Keep them strong. Give them peace to do their difficult work with dignity and sensitivity. We pray for all of those who work with alcoholics and drug addicts. Use them to make a difference in people's lives and help them to start their life anew. Be with those who suffer from food, shelter, and employment insecurities. Protect them. Guide them to available resources. Teach us to give of our abundance and offer wise and discerning guidance. Help us to live daily in Christ, who faced death in the certain hope of resurrection. Remind us, comfort us, and embolden us every day with your promise of new and eternal life in this life and in the life to come. Heavenly Father, through the death and resurrection of your Son, you rescue us from death and the grave. You give us hope and the promise of your Holy Spirit to guide us. Restore us to life so that we may serve you, bringing hope and healing into this broken world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And together we pray, as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Friends in Christ, receive the gift of the Holy Spirit so that you may live in Christ, love in Christ, and go forth to serve in Christ. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forever. Amen.
Amen.